All policies support.
Thanks, Riv. That's right. I am here with Adrian after their victory. Congratulations. A lot of people always talk about chaos when you're talking about Team Impulse games. I want to know, what is the communication actually like, you know, in game for Team Impulse?
Just fighting. Like, Xiao Zhao always wants to fight.
So it is chaos. All right. Now, the preparation that you guys have coming into the games, though, you know, preparing for lane swaps or level ones, stuff like that, you know, how, what is the preparation like for your team? You know, how early do you guys start that?
We started, like, usually the day before, actually. And, like, it's, like, we have a special plan for each team, and, like, Rush does most of it.
Rush is the mastermind.
He's the mastermind?
Mastermind, yeah.
All right. Well, you guys also, as a bottom lane, not a lot of people talk about you guys when they're talking about Team Impulse. You get overlooked sometimes, especially with a lot of the hyped bottom lanes in the North American LCS. What do you think is your biggest strength that you guys bring to the team?
We're consistent. We never lose lane, but we never win. But we don't need to lose. We don't lose.
That's a good thing to bring. Never lose lane. All right, we are going to send it back over to the guys at the desk.
Thank you, Kobe. Now Tip 2-2, Cloud 9-1-3. The best start for them. Looking at how this developed, though, Zhao Wei Zhao picking the LeBlanc into his ear, which is the reverse of the matchup that he had yesterday against Bjergsen, works out much better for him this time. So it seems like having that more aggressive, assassin-oriented champion that allows him to put that split push pressure on the map is more where he wants to live.
I mean, that's always been Xiao Wei Xiao's style. I mean, we're looking at the bans against TIP, and it's Yasuo and Fizz, and it has been for the last three games. Like, these are the things that Xiao Wei Xiao plays. Remember, last split, he had a great win over TSM where he played Kassadin. Like, that's the type of champions we see Xiao Wei Xiao do well. And as much as people say, well, the meta is team fighting mages, if your team functions playing things off meta, I realize LeBlanc is common, but stay with me here. but if you're playing these more individualistic champions and that works for you, then great, stick with it. And I think that's a very good thing for Team Impulse overall.
Yeah, I know he wants to play the Azir, though, and have more teamfight coordination. Like I said, I ran into him in solo queue, and I was like, why are you in my ELO? He's like dropped 200 points from playing Azir and losing a whole bunch of games.
Yeah.
I was like, he's definitely trying to learn this champion and pick it up so he can expand that pool.
And that makes sense. I mean, TSM tried to do that last split as well, where they're like, all right, we realize all these things work, and we know Bjergsen and Karius and LeBlanc. Let's learn Lissandra. Let's learn these other things. So I understand the growth aspect of it and want to do other things. And I guess you can balance like sticking with your identity versus learning other ones.
Yeah, I think what it ultimately does is it calls into question his pick yesterday as opposed to taking the Kassadin. Because you pointed out, Kassadin fits into that wheelhouse of how Zhao Zhao wants to play. It was available to him, would have been a fine pick in that scenario, didn't go with it. So more so, his pick today is a comment on yesterday than today itself.
Sure.
As the game develops, though, one thing I want to point out here is that Cloud9's early game was much better than it has been in the last few games. As they got out to an early lead, they secured their dragon, they dealt with the split push the lane swap pretty well, got those early turret dives.
Mm-hmm. And the level one from CNN overall, and just sort of like the first five-ish minutes of the game, looks like a standard rehearsed level one. Like, you and I played on a team together, and like, I would just go watch LCS VODs, look at everywhere the jungler and top laner went, and be like, okay, we can literally just copy CLG's jungle route and take a dragon and kill a turret. And like, we rehearsed that in like 5v0 games. And it's good that C9's clearly able to still do that without high end there. Like, they've learned like other level one setups. The question still comes in, like, what happens when people gum up the works, right? TIP didn't do anything special compared to like what we've seen like Gravity do, where they had really awesome level ones where they counterplayed it. And so that's still something you've got to see tested from C9.
There's also, once you get away from the routine and you hit that mid game, which TIP kind of has a really bloodbath type of style, and C9 more controlled. C9, they're kind of falling away from the controlled style. Like Meteos, he seems like one of those guys, and like you said, we played on a team before, where it's, I'm also like that, where the beginning of the game, I will know what to do, but then as the game pans out, you're like, okay, I am a resource that I need to be directed towards. Like, do you need me top? Do you need me bottom? I'm not going to ask you, please call for me, right? I'm going to farm camps. I'm going to look for things, sort of. But what are you on the same page with me as? And that's the communication that I think they're lacking, is Meteos stepping up as the shot caller. how much is he tapping into his laners? How much information is everybody giving him that he can work off of? Because he seemed to be a resource-type player when Hive was around. Now he is...
Yeah, he's got to be proactive.
He needs resources into him.
Right, exactly. And we see some of that breakdown of communication 26 minutes into the game here. We're going to pull up our replay. Freak's going to take this one away. But around the Dragon Pit, this is the turning point of the game.
And exactly. This is a big lead for C9. They're starting the Dragon. Impulse are, like, flooding in. The teleport's coming in. And... C9 needs to make a choice. They've got enough engage with Nautilus and Gragas to pick one side of the fight and go for it. But the problem is C9 lets Impulse do what they want. Shall I show folks? Okay, Impact's on one side. The AD carry is on the other. Incarnation peels out and gets himself surrounded. And now Impulse can just collapse into the C9 team that never did anything. Despite the fact that C9 have the wards to spite everything out, a bunch of great AoE damage comes out. And Incarnation, who's supposed to peel for Sneaky, ults after Sneaky's already dead. Apollo simply sidesteps it, gets out of soldier range, so Incarnation can't even fight back. And this is C9 not having the, you know, 4 seconds ago should have been the proactive call to say, we're going to peel off and go on this guy. And with Nautilus and Gragas, you can kill a Janna, or you can kill a Rumble, or you can even, like, pile dive on the Sejuani if you really want to. But none of those calls were made, and they sat there going, oh, crap, it's too late.
Yeah, and you can see from Incarnation, he didn't even have a soldier out until Janna had ultied at that point. He didn't prep the fight at all. He wasn't in position to, because Apollo was right above him threatening if he does stop to place a soldier at all, mm-hmm. he'll get some auto attacks in there. And then his contribution to the fight was W, Q, E, I get knocked back by Janna, I R, and then I have to walk away and die. Like, right. That's all he did that fight, because a lot of Azir is prepping with one soldier up so you can Q, so you can E ahead of time, and then get the second one up for more DPS. But right. he didn't do any of that.
Yeah, I mean, you're supposed to just, as Azir as a champion, have 2 to 3 soldiers up at all times just for damage output purposes. And right.
But he had not having the threat around him, so he couldn't actually prep it.
Sure. But yeah, I mean, this is all just, you know, foreplanning, seeing wards. This all should be prepped by C9.
Yeah, I think the point about being proactive and having the forethought to, if and when Team Impulse decides they want to engage on us while we're doing this dragon, what are we going to do, right? Yeah. Not waiting until it happens to then say, I don't know, I guess fight. But that continued to plague them throughout the game. Now they lose the dragon, they lose Baron off of that as well. It's a huge gold swing for Impulse, and that's where it just seemed like they were entirely lost on how to find their way back into the game.
Yeah. There was a call that I actually will defend. I know Jet didn't like it on the cast, and I know a lot of people are going to give me maybe flack for this one. so I want to first preface by saying I don't like results-driven analysis, meaning like C9 lost when they went for Baron. Clearly, it was a bad call. I think the Baron call from C9 when they tried to get back in was the only choice they had left. No one could hold up to the little block split push. They had a non-TP champion on the wrong side of the map. Going for Baron was the right choice here. It just simply didn't pan out because, well, you're already behind. It's going to happen sometimes. Anyway, like, we got to see glimmers of, like, Meteos making a good call with his team behind, right? Like, we've seen now C9 do a good job early game. We've seen them actually hold up in lanes for once. Okay, a bad dragon call, but, like, they even made a good comeback attempt. Like, we're seeing some growth for this team. They are still losing, but, like, as far as that specific call goes, I liked it.
Yeah, and I want to talk about some TIP growth, too, because Xiaowei Xiao's split push, that's something he's always done, like, oh, on Yasuo and things like that, on the LeBlanc, and then solo killing Balls while he's TPing and getting kind of that lucky kill where Balls didn't look like he was looking and the chain right when he started it was really big, because then he got turrets off of that, he got pressure, he got more gold in his inventory, and he helped open up the map. He got an inhibitor by himself.
Yep.
Like, that's a big thing there, and Xiaowei Xiao's the guy, it's like, sink or swim, like, what's happening with him? He waxes and wanes with basically the day. So finally a really good game from him. So shout-outs to that.
Yeah, 805 applied a lot of pressure there. He's a person we've been looking to really step up and bring Tip to the next level. Now looking ahead to our marquee matchup, CLG has arrived. They are in the house. Here they are just a few minutes ago, heading into the studio, warming up for their big game. I'm sure Doublelift, Afromu are going to be a big part of that victory if it comes. And next up, Team Liquid, though, they will look to extend their hot streak when they take on Gravity in our second game of the day. A lot of action coming your way, and it all continues in just 3.5.
Did the lobby sneaky?
Huh?
Lobby sneaky?
Let me solo Baron. One sec.
Just let him solo Baron. So we'll know if he can do it in the real game.
Yeah, we'll tell broadcast, you know,
we were going to start on time, but Sneaky has to solo Baron for the custom game real quick.
Have to.
Meteos could also go down. The teleport from Balls a little far away, and they are just walking on the red carpet. Equalizer coming in from Impact. Two-man ultimate. Sneaky's actually on the front there. Now he's forcing the Dragon Pit, and Dragon's attacking him. A good hit from Apollo takes him down. Could hit the full team here. A nice hit back by the Emperor's Divide. Impact and Rush in a bad spot here. Incarnation takes a few shots.
Here, right. Here.
I'm coming.
Yeah, Zhonya.
No Zhonya. Kite.
Okay.
Show
the one.
Azir down.
Okay.
Nice.
What the?
Yeah, bottom done. GG.
Team Impulse, take down Cloud9.